Good afternoon. This is our fourth lecture, and this week we are going to discuss the 1949 Great Retreat, and the subtitle is Tone Between Two Worlds. Okay. And before going into the lecture, I'm going to tell a story, a real story of my family, because my father-in-law he's from Shandong, you know, it's a province in the North China. Okay. And here's the story. At the last phase of the Chinese Civil War, at that stage, there's a very great shortage in the manpower of the troops. So both KMT and CPC, they tried to procure more soldiers from their villages, especially the provincial village. And so one day, my father-in-law's brother, his elder brother, was drafted by KMT. So he had to go to the war field. But the problem is that his brother just got married. So both his sister-in-law, that's the brother's wife, and his mother begged my father-in-law that he should substitute his brother and go to the troop. And but if you are going to do this, you have to change your name. So my father-in-law changed his name, and he used his brother's name to go into the troop. But it's very bad because the situation is getting worse. Was getting worse. So basically, they did not engage. After he entered the troop, they did not engage the communist troops because the nationalist armies, they are losing ground. They were losing ground, so they kept running and running southward. They ran to Hainan Island, the southernmost province of China, and after Hainan Island, he went to Taiwan with the army. Okay, so he was separated from his family for more than, I think it's 38 years. Okay, so not until after 1949, not until 1987, they were able to contact their families in mainland China. And before that, if they want to contact their family, they have to, of course, you know, the mail cannot be, the letters cannot be, in Taiwan, the letters cannot be mailed to mainland China directly. So they have to mail the letter to America, to a friend, and the friend mail the letter to mainland China. So it's very troublesome. Also, this is the real story of my father-in-law. And after 1987, I think it's in the 90s, he finally had a chance to go back to his hometown, and it's almost 40 years later. So this is a tragic story of the time. But I think this is not unique, but because many of the mainlanders in Taiwan have this kind of story. They left behind their families back in mainland China, and they went to Taiwan. But I think my father-in-law is, in a sense, he's very lucky because he has many friends and families in Taiwan. But in many of the stories that we are going to read this semester, we see some of the mainlanders, they went to Taiwan alone without any friends and families. So they are very eager to find family in Taiwan. And sometimes this will result in some kind of tragedy. Okay, so this is what happened after 1949. Okay, so the two words means Taiwan and Taiwan and mainland China. Okay, this is where the story begins. That we know this is the in the middle of this picture is the American ambassador Patrick Hurley. And on his right side is Mao Zedong. On his left side is Zhou Enlai, two of the most important figures in CPC. Okay, and on the right side of Mao Zedong is KMT general, and this general is named Zhang Zizhong. Later on, he defected to CPC. So we can see that how serious the problem is. So this picture was taken around 1945, after the Second Sino-Japanese War. American government decided to engage in the problem of the Chinese Civil War. So they want to get two sides into some kind of negotiation. But I think this is an American way of thinking, because in China we say that if you are enemy, I cannot share the ground with you. So this is a Chinese way of thinking, the fight to the death way of thinking. Okay, so this is 1945, and this one is a historical picture taken. Okay, of course, it's taken around maybe I think around August or September of 1945, because we know that there are a few pictures in which Mao Zedong and Chiang Kai-shek, they took pictures together. And the one behind Chiang Kai-shek, no, I mean the one behind the ambassador is Jiang Jingguo, the son of Chiang Kai-shek. Okay, so this is taken during the negotiation, the political negotiation between CPC and KMT. Okay. So I think if you want to know a little about this part of the Chinese history, we can roughly divide it into several parts. The first phase is in Manchuria. Manchuria means northeastern China. Okay. Because we know that at the final stage of the Second World War, Soviet Russia decided to invade Manchuria, and they sent many Russian troops into this area. Okay, of course, basically the Japanese troops did not resist, because the emperor, the Japanese emperor, had just announced the surrender. Okay, so in this phase, we know that the Russian troops invaded into this area. So basically, after this was done, the communists started to take over many of the military resources left behind by the Japanese. And many of the provincial area in Manchuria were controlled by CPC armies. Okay, so there started to some kind of clashes between the nationalist and CPC armies. Okay, and by late 1948, CPC armies took important cities like Shenyang and Changchun. Okay, so we know that at this stage, KMT armies started to lose ground. And from late 1948 to early 1949, I think it's a very key moment of modern Chinese history. Because at this stage, the CPC armies, they started to take northern China, although with great casualties. Okay, they lost a lot of lives during this kind of battles. Okay, and there's also a key event, because on January 22nd, the highest commander of the nationalist armies in northern China, his the general named Fu Zhuoyi, defected to CPC. Because Fu Zhuoyi, his daughter, is a very famous communist. So we know that Fu Zhuoyi was persuaded by his daughter to surrender to the CPC, CPC army. Okay, so on 31st, without confronting any resistance, People's Liberation Army took Beiping and renamed this city as Beijing. Okay? And so very quickly, it only took like about 3 months to cross Yangtze River, the Long River. and they took Nanking. Nanking is the capital of KMT, right? And they took Nanking in only 2 days after they crossed the Yangtze River. From this picture taken in 1949, we can know the situation in that time. Because in this picture, we see the PLA, the army of CPC. They are welcomed by the citizens of Beiping. Okay, so maybe there's a problem, okay, because they cannot rule the China very well. So there are many corrupt corrupted officials, corrupted soldiers, corrupted generals. So now they are not welcomed by the citizens. So when the PLA went into the city, they are even welcomed by the people there. And they did not meet any resistance. And this is also a very important thing in modern Chinese history, because on October 1st, 1949, so we know that the national holiday is for mainland China is October 1st, okay? On this day, a grand ceremony was witnessed by 300,000 people in Beijing's Tiananmen Square, okay? Mao Zedong, chairman of the Central People's Government, declared that the founding of the People's Republic of China, PRC. Okay. And this is this event took place in Tiananmen Square. Okay, so Tiananmen Square is a very important place in modern Chinese history. This is Tiananmen Square. Have you ever been to China? Yeah. Then you never been there, okay? No. And how many of you have ever been to China? Oh, many of you. So where did you go?
I went to Xi'an, Beijing.
Xi'an, Beijing, okay?
Shanghai.
Shanghai. And which one do you like the most?
I went to Beijing and Xi'an like 10 years ago, and Shanghai I went
10 years ago? Whoa, it's a long time. 2 years ago, like, so you go to the World Exhibition, right?
Maybe 3 years ago. I didn't see the World
Exhibition. Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah, but yeah. It keeps changing. Yeah, my dad goes there. So.
Mm-hmm. And what's your impression about Beijing?
When I went, they had a lot of beggars.
Beggars, okay.
So they kept
holding my family. I think they are all gone after the Olympic Games. Because they started to crack down on beggars a lot. And there are many ridiculous things about the Chinese government. For example, when they were going to hold the Olympic Games, you know the grassland, there are many grasslands in Beijing, and some of the grasslands are not green, so they decided to paint the grassland to green. So it's very ridiculous. But it's true. I saw this from the news channel in Taiwan. Okay, but that's another thing. And Yolanda, where did you go?
I went to Beijing.
Beijing, do you like it?
It wasn't my favorite.
Oh, you're not your favorite. No. Why? Because you think what's the shortcoming of Beijing? Mm-hmm. Yeah, because Shanghai is obviously more modernized, right? Yeah, but I think Beijing has some kind of ancient feeling, so I like it better than Shanghai. Because for me, Shanghai is too much like Taipei, don't you think so? Right? The Starbucks, the coffee shops in Shanghai, or the metro in Shanghai, right? Right. Yeah, Miss Yamamoto, did you went to mainland China? No, you should go. You can use this time. You stay in Taiwan. You can find a vacation or weekend to make a short visit to China. It's a very interesting place. Then and you should go too. But whether you like it or not, I think once in your lifetime, you should go there and find what really Chinese is. Because I don't think that Taiwan is Chinese enough. If you want to get to know real Chinese, mainland China is a real place. Okay. So if you have a chance to go to Beijing, go there. Oh, this is a very, because when you went to the Tiananmen Square, you always see a lot of people. In Chinese, we say, Ren San Ren Hai, people, mountain, people, sea. There's always a lot of people there. I don't know what's the occasion, because we see a few people on the square. So it's kind of strange for me. Okay. And this picture is also very interesting, because you see in the middle of this picture, we see this woman, this lady is Song Qingling. He's the wife of late Dr. Sun Yat-sen. And so we know that, but I'm not quite sure if we know the story, because Dr. Sun Yat-sen has maybe his second wife or third wife. And Chiang Kai-shek also had his second wife. And their wives are actually sisters. And this Song Qingling is the second daughter of the Song family, and Chiang Kai-shek's wife Song Meiling is the third daughter of the family. So actually, that's a very political family of modern China. And Song Qingling, she decided to stand for CPC and stay in China after 1949, and she became very important in the government. So this is she's also attending the ceremony. Okay, so after the final phase of this part of history, we know that the escape route of the KMT government, first they went from Nanking to Guangzhou, you know the capital of Canton, right? And later they went to Chongqing. Chongqing is the capital during the Second Sino-Japanese War. And later on they went to Chengdu. Okay, after Chengdu they went to Taipei. I think it's in December 1949. And some part of the armies went to Xichang, an important city in the southwest China. But those armies were finally eradicated by CPC. So it's very tragic. And after 1949, I think the KMT government tried to maintain some kind of political mobility. They want to tell the people that we still want to fight back. We want to fight back and retrieve mainland. So this is their political slogan heard all the time during that period. For example, the first one is Fan Gong Da Lu, fight back and retrieve the mainland. We always say this slogan in political occasions. And the second one is unify China with the three principles of the people. 三民主义统一中国. As you can see in this picture, this is 三民主义统一中国. Unify China with the three principles of the people. What is the three principles of the people? This is the economic and the political teachings left behind by Dr. Sun Yat-sen. So KMT government thought that they are the real inheritor of Dr. Sun Yat-sen. But it's very strange. In a sense, the communists thought they are real inheritors of Dr. Sun Yat-sen. So they are both inheritors of Dr. Sun Yat-sen. Okay? And this picture is taken in 2003, October 2003. And propaganda sign in Jinmen. If you have a telescope in mainland China, you can see it from mainland China. So in this picture, we see a group of veterans or mainlanders. They are petitioning for a lift of the ban on visiting their relatives in mainland China. So they took the picture, the portrait of President Chiang Kai-shek and President Jiang Jingguo, because President Jiang Jingguo just died at that time. So after in 1987, the KMT government lifted the ban on visiting the relatives in mainland China. So this is after the martial law had been lifted on July 15th. Okay. And in 1993, the people in mainland China were allowed to enter Taiwan for a short-term or permanent residence with their relatives. So in this, the story, the assigned reading this week, my relatives in Hong Kong, right? We see that there's a conversation between the elder sister and the son, because the elder sister thought that she's not going to, it was impossible for her to get out of Beijing. Okay, because we know that at that time, it's the aftermath of the Cultural Revolution, because the economic situation is not very good. So many of the Chinese people, they want to get out to Hong Kong, get out to maybe to America or anything, any country will do. But of course, this is not the case right now, because they are very proud of their economic situation right now. But I mean, after 1993, they have this kind of option. They can go to Taiwan and reunite with their families in Taiwan. Okay. And for the stories of 1949, well, I think there are many tragic stories of the period. And I will recommend this story, but because this story is not translated into English. Into English, it only has a Chinese version. But if you have the, if you can read in Chinese, you should read the story. This story is very, this is a very painstaking story. Because this story is, I have mentioned it in the introductory lecture, the Dragon Inn, Long Tian Lou. Long Tian Lou is a restaurant in Taichung, and it sells the cuisine of Shanxi province. Okay? And this story is written in the very traditional way. You know that what is the traditional novel? Have you ever heard the story Canterbury Tales or Italian stories Decamero, right? These people, they choose a place to get together, and they started to tell their stories one by one. They took turns to tell their stories. Okay, so this is the form of the story. Four mainlanders, they get together in the Dragon Inn, and they started to tell their own stories. Of course, their stories, the stories about their escape from the mainland, okay, and what they have gone through in this process. And in this story, we see, of course, this is a novella, because this is a little bit long piece of short story. This short story is comprised of four stories about a general and some hiring officer. They are all from Taiyuan City. And we know that Taiyuan City is a very, very famous famous place in this part of history, because we know that there are 500 martyrs of Taiyuan. In Chinese, we say Taiyuan 500. There are 500 people after the CPC armies get into Taiyuan City. They chose to commit suicide. They chose to commit suicide. So KMT government call it martyrs, the 500 martyrs of this Taiyuan City. This story is written in the background, because through the recounts of the four high-ranking officials, high-ranking officers, we know that the CPC armies get into the Taiyuan City. And in a great contrast of these martyrs of Taiyuan, we see this general, General Guan, he's a castrated general, because according to his own account, he was captured by the CPC army, And originally, he thought that he would be executed, but in the end, he did not. He was not executed, but the CPC army chose to castrate him, so he's not a martyr. He's a disabled man in Taiwan. And one thing in common with all these high-ranking officers in Taiwan, their fate in Taiwan, they only can scrape a meager living, because after they went to Taiwan, they are no longer generals or officers. They were discharged from the army, and they have to find a way to make a living. So two of them opened a breakfast diner in Taichung, and one of them raised chicken to make a living, and one of them became a guard for a church, for American church. So this is a story about the Dragon Inn. And the writings of generals. Last week we have talked about the short story by Guo Songfeng, right? Brightly shine the stars tonight. 今夜星光灿烂. That is a story about Chen Yi. And why this? I think this is a very important literary culture in post-Taiwan fiction, post-war Taiwan fiction, because we know that generals are influential figures in the making of history, and which justifies to be written in fiction. We all know that, not only in Chinese writing, well, in the Western writing, we know a lot about the writings on generals. And generals can be victorious or defeated, and due to a great retreat, in Taiwan's literary culture, we see a lot of defeated generals and their tragic lives. Okay, so the authors contribute to this genre of writing include Zhu Xinying. So we can see that in this very long lineage, we see that from anti-communist writing to postmodern writing, we can see a lot of writers they devoted themselves to this kind of writing. Zhu Xinying, Bai Xianyong. Zhu Xinying is an anti-communist writer. Bai Xianyong and Wang Wenxin, they are modernist writers. And Guo Songfeng, he's usually considered to be a modernist writer, but I think his piece, 今夜星光灿烂, I think is some kind of postmodern writing. And Huang Fan and Zhang Dachun. Okay, we're going to introduce these stories one by one. And if you are interested in this kind of writings on generals, you can check these two novels and by the two famous writers. The one, of course, both of these two writers, they were in the new continent, I mean America. Okay. The first one is he's more world famous. He's Gabriel Garcia Marquez. He's the Nobel Prize winner. Okay, and he has this piece of work, The General in His Labyrinth. This novel is about the great liberator of Latin America, Simon Bolivar. Simon Bolivar is a 19th century Colombian general. He started to fight against the Spanish Empire and started to help the Latin Americans escape from this Lat Empire. And the second one is American novelist. I don't know whether you have heard this writer, E.L. Doctorow. He's a historical novelist, but he always write about history. He used elements, historical elements, to create his novels. That one is The March, a novel about General William Tecumseh Sherman of the Union Army, recounting his military activities in the late phase of the American Civil War. Do you know this General Sherman? Yeah? Yolanda, what do you know about this General Sherman? Yeah.
Really well. He marched through Atlanta and he marched through Charleston and he set fire to everything.
Yeah, so that's basically what this story is about. It is about the victims of the war, right? And we also know that he's a successor of Ulysses Grant, right? He took the commanding general's position from Ulysses Grant. Okay, so this story is about, of course, not only about the general himself, but also about all the people, all the soldiers, all the citizens influenced by his military decisions. Okay, the two cases about the writing of generals. And these are the cases in Taiwan. One is Zhu Xining, the commanding general, Zhang Junling. This is not, of course, this is a biographical novel. It's written on the basis of the lives of 12 generals. So some people say that this is a biography, it's not a novel. And the two, Wang Wenxing, the Dragon Inn, and Bai Xianyong, we're going to introduce it later. And Guo Songfeng, Brightly Shine Star Tonight. This is a novel based on the last days of General Chen Yi. Last week we have talked about Chen Yi, right? Because we know that after the 228 incident, Chen Yi was not punished. He was even rewarded by President Chiang Kai-shek. And but at the last phase of the Chinese Civil War, we know that Chen Yi tried to defect to the CPC camp. So Chen Yi was arrested by the KMT government. And he was at first imprisoned in Shanghai. And later, after the Great Retreat, they moved him to Keelung. And he was executed in Taipei. Okay. But this piece of work is really different because from the traditional perspective of history, we know that Chen Yi is usually regarded as some kind of betrayer. Of course, because he wants to defect to the CPC camp. But in this short story, Guo Songfeng tries to escape from this kind of contrast between or this kind of dichotomy between the CPC and KMT, and went beyond to this political struggle. And he used this General Chen Yi to think about the possibility of history or the province of history. Because we know that after the Republic of China has been established, we have a lot of wars in China. So he started to think about whether or not KMT government have done something good to the people. Okay, this is a very interesting story. And this one is Jiang Junbei. It's a postmodern short story by Zhang Dachun. In this semester we have a chance to read Zhang Dachun in the later part of this semester. This is a magical realist short story. So we know that Latin America, the magical realism is the most popular form of novel in Latin America. But in Taiwan, during the 1980s, we have some of the writers, they writings based on this kind of genre. And Zhang Dachun is one of its major practitioners. And in this short story, we know that this is a story about a general. And this general, someday he found himself, he had this kind of ability to travel through time. So he has a chance to went back to the Northern Expedition, the April 12th incident in Shanghai, and the Second Sino-Japanese War. And he went back to these historical events and to reflect on all these events. Of course, for the title, we know that there is a general's monument, because after the general died, people established a monument for him. But in the end of the story, the monument was destroyed by the general himself. And this is very symbolic, because it presents some kind of questionability of history. Because we know that on the monument, people write about what the general do, the achievement of the general, right? But this kind of act of destroying the monument represents some kind of questionability of history. And this also represents some kind of political atmosphere of Taiwan around the mid-1980s, because we know that after 1987, the martial law has been lifted. But around, after 1980s, after the Formosa incident, Taiwan started to be politically chaotic, and the president Jiang Jingguo decided to implement a series of democratic reform. So the political atmosphere during that time is very free. So the writers were able to write about this kind of political problems, political and historical problems. And another important novel by Wang Wenxing, besides the dragon in his family catastrophe, it has an English translation. If you are interested, you can get a copy to read it. This story is this novel is a story recounting the protagonist Fan Ye's childhood and how his relationship with his father kept worsening, and the later finally left home without being found for 2 years. So we know that this is a most typical way of writing the modernist world. You combine your past, the events in the past and the events in the present together, and you mix them. And so sometimes you have there's many problems in this kind of narration. So this is a combination of past and present. And we know that the father was from a family of high-ranking officials in Qing Dynasty. Okay, and he used to be a student in France. We know that in mainland China, you don't see a lot of students from foreign countries. They are Chinese students, and they went to places like Japan, America, and France to learn. And later on, they went back to China, and they were able to procure some kind of high position in the government, or they can be very great teachers. But after 1949, things changed, because we know that after the Great Retreat, this family, Fan Ye, the protagonist's father, he went from Amoy to Taiwan. Amoy is a very important city in Fujian, in the province of Fujian. And in this novel, we see that his failures in his public servant career, and the family also always had a problem, economic problem, because the money was always tight. And in this novel, we also see, because basically the family is a typical mainlanders family. But the elder brother of Fan Ye, he wanted to get married with a Taiwanese girl, but his father did not agree with him. So this, because the Taiwanese girl, for one thing, the girl is Taiwanese, and for another, because this girl is a former taxi dancer, so his father was very angry. But this also showed the problem in Taiwan, social problem in Taiwan, because it is not very easy for a Taiwanese man to get married with a mainlander girl, or Taiwanese girl to get married with a mainlander man, okay. And Fan Ye had always felt humiliated in his childhood for poverty, because the money is always tight. And after he became a teaching assistant in a university, he took over the rank of family, and. He was very mean to his father. So finally, his father decided to leave. But what is strange is that after the father left for 2 years, the family seemed not to be influenced, because it's always the same before and after the father has left. So after the publication of this novel, Wang Wenxing was severely criticized by the society, because this is not a traditional way of looking at the father-son relationship. And the next story we're going to, we introduce here is a short story from Taipei People, by, from Bai Xianwen's Taipei People. A Sea of Blood Red Azaleas is published in 1969. This is the fifth story in Taipei People, first published in modern literature, 现代文学. In this short story, we see Wang Xiong. He's a protagonist. He's a discharged veteran from Hunan province. We know that Taipei People is not really about Taipei. They are not from Taipei. They are from mainland, and they live from all places in mainland. And this Wang Xiong, he's not well educated, because as I have said, for example, my father-in-law's story, many of them were drafted by KMT government forcibly, so they have no other choice. They have to go to they have to be drafted, and he went to Taiwan and became discharged, and he became the janitor for a welfare family in Taipei. The problem comes because Wang Xiong was greatly nostalgic. He missed his mother, and he has a 10-year-old fiance in the mainland, because we know that in Chinese tradition, if the families has money, they will buy a girl from other village or the same village. And of course, this is originally an adopted girl, adopted daughter. But in the end, this kind of daughter will be the daughter-in-law, because if they have a son, finally the girl will get married with the son. So Wang Xiong is pissed, because he has a 10-year-old fiance in his hometown. When he left mainland, the girl, his fiance, or his fiance in the future, was still 10 years old. So the problem comes, he became pretty close and obsessed with the 10-year-old daughter of his employer. He relied on the daughter emotionally. So this is not very something very good for Wang Xiong. So when the girl grew up, he detested Wang's company, and making him desperate. And so Wang Xiong finally decided to kill himself. So in this kind of story, we have a lot of cases of suicide. And the second one is this is not about suicide, but this is a story about death. This is Glorious by Blossom Bridge, Hua Qiao Rongji. Glorious was a diner in Taipei, and the owner is a mainland woman from Guangxi province. We know that Bai Xianyong and his father, Bai Chongxi, were from Guangxi province, the Guilin city in Guangxi province. And the story is about all her customers. And the stories were narrated from the perspective of the owner of this diner. And the story depicts how mainlanders from Guangxi adapted to their lives as Taipei people. But I think the point is that they adapted their lives poorly. They did not do very good at this in this regard. For example, one of the customer of this diner, he's the richest timber merchant in Guangxi. And after he went to Taiwan, he lost all his money, of course. And he became an old man. And an old man relied wholly on his son. So he's very sad. So after celebrating his own 70th birthday, he committed suicide. And another is the former county governor from Guangxi. After fire by City Hall, he became insane. And after flood, he ended up being found dead in the ditch. This is also a very sad story. But these are all episodes in this short story. The main story in this, the main episode in this short story is the protagonist in this, protagonist in this story is the elementary school teacher. This teacher is from Guilin City, the same city with Bai Xianyong. He saved money for 15 years in order to smuggle his girlfriend from the mainland. Because at that time, we know that if you have money and you find the right people, you can smuggle mainlanders from the border of Hong Kong. They have this kind of arrangement. So this elementary school teacher, he thought that he can do this. So he gave all his money to his cousin. But his cousin tricked him of all his money. And he became hopeless and corrupted. He started to drink or smoke a lot. And finally died from heart attack. But this is also a very tragic story. Okay, and this is the first case. The first case, of course, we have introduced this story in our introductory lecture, so we can skip this. But one very important thing about this story is that in this story, we see a sentence stated by one of the protagonists, the police, again and again. There must be a reason. Okay, there must be. He thought like, because he's a policeman who's in charge of security job, he had to find a reason for the suicide. And he thought that there must be a reason. But in the end, after his investigation, we don't see a very justified reason for this suicide, the case of suicide. And this is the two statements of, from the man who committed suicide. The first one, he said that it's as if you've been sailing for a long time and suddenly the compass is broken, the thrust defaced, the well is damaged, and even the wind stops blowing. So we know that this man who committed suicide, Hu Xinbao, he is a very hard worker, and he studies very hard after he went to Taiwan. And he has a good wife, his daughter, and he even had a mistress. But in the end, he know that these are all meaningless, so he committed suicide. Okay. So the second one is, he said that we are like branches cut off, lying on the ground. So this is some kind of attitude of the mainlanders in Taiwan. They don't think Taiwan is their home, so they feel they are rootless. Okay, this is one of the major problems with them. Okay. So here goes our first short story this week. My relatives in Hong Kong. Of course, from the title, we know that this is a very strange story, because relatives in this title has at least many levels of sense. For example, you can say that the relatives are the cousin Jin Jin, the young man who grew up in Hong Kong, right? And the relatives, you can say that they are the grandmother of the father, right? The son, okay? And you can also say that the relatives the cousin Dao from Beijing. Right, so this is a very interesting title. And also, we know that Xiao Sa, the writer, the writer of this short story, he's a female writer, but he focuses on many social problems. So when he was writing this short story, you see that 1986, after 11 years, there will be a handover of Hong Kong. Do you know what hangover, the word hangover is? Okay, we'll talk about it next class. How old were you when Hong Kong was handed over to China?
Six
years old, okay. So you're pretty young. And so how much do we know about the handover? Yes.
And everybody was kind of freaking out because they didn't know what China was going to do. But it turns out they didn't really do anything.
Yeah. I like the word you use, freak out. Because from the content of this short story, we know that the Hong Kong people are really freaked out, right? So it's a story about how they freak out. So sometimes, at that period, sometimes Taiwanese people feel we are very happy. because we don't have to worry about that. But of course, we had some kind of crisis in the past of 3 or 4 decades. But that's nothing like the handover of Hong Kong. Okay. So, are you going to make your report first, and we can continue the discussion? Are you going to make report here, there, or here?
It doesn't matter.
It doesn't. Oh, please.
So when I first read this story, one of the first things that struck me was the comparison between like the different, like the women from Taiwan and the women from mainland China, because the author kind of describes the women from Taiwan as really nagging and like very full of contempt for the men in the story. But on the other hand, in China, the elder mother, or was she, what do they call her?
The grandmother.
The grandmother and yeah. The sister, they're like really self-sacrificing, and that they suffered a lot. And so as the audience, we're supposed to feel pity for them and admiration for all that they've gone through, whereas we don't have this feeling for the Taiwanese women. But I think in the end, they're kind of redeemed because they do show up to meet the son and the father, so they kind of accept their apology. I think also in the, it also shows the role of women in the story, because a lot of the times they feel, or at least they're shown to feel, very helpless because, for example, Whitney, she just has to accept that her husband is going to take like $8,000 out of the bank and just to give to her, to his father, and she can't really do anything about it, but she's not really approving of it because they do have all this debt that they just incurred, and they're like getting a new house and a new car and things like that. And she has to go ask for money from her family.
So, would an American woman do that?
Do what?
Do, for example, borrow money from your mother or father and give it to your husband?
Mm-hmm. Like
you mean you will you will get a loan from a bank,
mm-hmm.
something like that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But what if you cannot get a loan from the bank?
And then I guess you do have to go to your family or your friends. But I don't know.
Or will you get a divorce?
I don't think it's quite so extreme.
Okay.
He was supposed to be there for his family, but he decided to just leave and go to Taipei and find a job. And because of that, his sister is very, very unhappy with him. She felt that for her, she had the duty to also stay home and take care of her parents. And because her brother left, the entire burden of that role was given to her. And then all of a sudden that comes out in like, page 159, And she's just like, have you ever done anything to fulfill your responsibility? And it seems kind of like a shock to him that he didn't know that she was so, she was harboring all this resentment. And then, also like you had, well you don't have here, there was the concept of being Chinese, and it was very interesting to me that even within Chinese society there was like the difference between how old you were, like the relation, like how you could relate to people older or younger than you. For example, there was a scene at the dinner table where the narrator, he couldn't really talk to people who, not like talk, but like converse with his elders. So instead he talked to his younger like nieces and nephews about their schooling instead. Mm-hmm. And also how the younger, the niece, she didn't want to go to school in Canada, or like she was scared about what would happen after the handover. And it was just like, even within people, the Chinese community, there was still that rift of where you're from and how you've grown up, even though I think you're all kind of the same. Another thing that I thought was really interesting was the idea of family helping family, even though like there's still that bond where there's examples of people helping their relatives escape from Red China, and then also how one of the uncles had the opportunity to possibly move to Canada if he didn't want to stay in Hong Kong. So I don't think you can find that very much in American literature, at least not that I can remember. And then I think after hearing, listening to your previous lecture, there was a very important part, a part that really resonated within me on the last page, like page 189, where the son says, what dad and mom would most like is for the four of us to live in this old house the same as we did before without changing anything. But in fact, that's not possible. And then it kind of seems to me that people who came over from the mainland to Taiwan just wanted everything to be the same as it was before, but time moves on without them, and they can't just, they're either stuck only living in the past, and then like when they realize that it's not like that anymore, they drastic things happen like suicide, or they have to kind of deal with not being where they want to be and being really upset.
Okay, thank you. The last point is very important, because that's why being a mainlander in Taiwan is so difficult. Because every now and then they feel that they are left over by the time. They cannot move forward with other people in Taiwan. Okay? So, and according to Yolanda's report, we see many family problems in this short story. Of course, this is what the short story is mainly about. Okay? So, we're going to see a little bit of other aspects of this short story. Like I say, this short story is written by Xiao Sa. Xiao Sa is a female writer focused on social criticism. And in this short story is very strange, because in 1986, Taiwanese people, the mainlanders on Taiwan, they were not allowed to go to China. So after, 1 year later, they were allowed to go into mainland China. So maybe the protagonist, the father and son, the short story, they have to go to some other place and then go to Hong Kong, because after 1987, Taiwanese people can apply for a visa to Hong Kong and Macau. So this is a detail about this short story. And so we see here, there's 1 year before mainlanders were allowed to visit Hong Kong and the mainland. Okay. And this is 11 years before the handover. So Yolanda said that she's only 6 years old. Okay, so James, how old were you 11?
During handover.
Oh, okay. So what do you remember about this handover? Because in that year, the news are all over the place. Because in Taiwan, we always read that this kind of news, and that kind of news about this handover.
I remember property market. People talk about the property market
mm-hmm.
going to collapse in Hong Kong.
Yes.
The property market in the U.S. going up because people are moving their money
mm-hmm.
in Canada, the U.S., Singapore.
So I can see your economics major. Yeah. And Catherine, how old were you at that time?
I was only 7.
7 years old, okay. So you are pretty young. And what do you remember about handover?
I don't
you don't remember a thing. Okay.
Yeah.
And have you ever been to Hong Kong?
Yeah.
And do you like Hong Kong?
Yeah, I like it more than China.
What do you like about it?
I like it more than China.
More than China. Mm-hmm. Many foreigners say that. But I think, of course, both Hong Kong and mainland China are Chinese, but it's different because we know that Hong Kong is a bit like Taiwan because Hong Kong has been colonized by British for more than 100 years. And just like Taiwan has been colonized by Japanese for 50 years. So the situation might be, we can compare Hong Kong and Taiwan, these two places. Okay. So that is a very important sentence in this short story. Yeah, we were all Chinese, but still we were different. Okay, so in this short story, the point is that of course, there are many important things in this short story, but one of the main things that we have to pay attention to is that we are all Chinese, but still we were different. What does that mean? Because we know that China, how many of you were Chinese? I'm not sure. Remember, you say you are Vietnamese. You're Chinese.
But my parents are from Vietnam.
Okay, so they are overseas Chinese. Okay, and Rachel, right? Rachel, are you Chinese? And from Taiwan or mainland?
My parents are from Hong Kong.
Hong Kong. Oh, really? Also, so I have to ask you about this story. And Samantha.
I'm Chinese too.
You're Chinese. Okay, I see. And Catherine, you are also Chinese, right?
My grandfathers are Western, my grandmothers are Native Chinese.
Oh, okay. So you are the second generation Chinese American?
My parents grew up here, so they went to Maplewood.
Oh, okay, I see.
Yeah,
I see.
So I'm first generation Chinese.
Mm-hmm. And Amanda, are you Chinese?
Yeah.
Okay. So maybe we can say that you, from a Chinese American perspective, you are also another version of Chinese, right? So you have to think a little bit about this problem. I think this is the main problem that make you think in this short story. Of course, you have to relate yourself to the story. You find something to talk about, find something to think about in this short story. Okay, and just like Melinda has reported, the gap between different generations of mainlanders in Taiwan, this is very interesting. For example, my father said that he had never imagined, this is from the beginning, the very beginning of the short story, the father said that he had never imagined his son would work for the Japanese. Why? Why did he say that? Then, what do you think about it? Why did the father say that?
The father said that because you're talking about Taiwanese father?
No, the mainland father. His father is a mainlander. And he said that he could not imagine his son would work for Japanese.
I think it's mainly because Taiwan changed ownership so many times
mm-hmm.
During, I guess, that interview period or so. It was really difficult to...
Yes. But that might be right. But I think the another great reason for this is that why? Because his father considered Japanese to be enemies, right? Why would my son be? Why would my son work for the enemies? Because his father fought with the enemies in the mainland, and later on they fought with the CPC, and later on they escaped to Taiwan. And today my son worked for the enemies of his older days. It's not acceptable for some of the mainlanders in Taiwan. But actually, after the Japanese left Taiwan, but their enterprises started to become more influential in Taiwan, I think it's since the late 70s or 80s. So there were many international companies from Japan in Taiwan, and they set up branches in Taiwan. And many of the people, Taiwanese people, work for them. And of course, because they are, if you are an international company employee, you get more pay. The pay is higher. So many Taiwanese are proud of it if you can get into an international company. So this is simply unacceptable for the father. Okay, so he would say he could not imagine one day his son would work for Japanese. Okay? So in this respect, we can see the transformation of the social values, because we know that the son worked in a Japanese trading company. And also, working overtime became an unwritten, because this is stated by the narrator. He says that from the son's perspective, he said that working overtime became an unwritten rule in the office, because someday, I think he has to leave the office earlier, and he's a little bit uneasy with this, because he has to leave earlier, and the other people were still working. If he felt it's very, might be embarrassing for him. So I think this is the problem in society, because after you get into a Japanese company, you found out, maybe originally we thought that Taiwanese were, we work hard, but Japanese work harder. So if you have a chance to work with Japanese, you will see that maybe all the Japanese, they are workaholic, and they ask their colleagues to do the same. So a lot of Taiwan and the international companies has become a new social issue. After the international companies get into Taiwan, and Taiwanese people working in these companies, they have to find a way to adapt to these companies. And there's also a very important urban problems, because we know that this short story is written in 1986. And the urban scene in Taiwan started to prosper after the late 1970s. So basically, after 1980s, we have urban literature. The stories are written by writers like Zhang Dazhun and Huang Fan. They focus on this urban problems. And in this short story, we also discuss urban problems. Well, maybe we can read a quotation from the short story. Of course, this is also a contrast between the father and the son, because the father chose to live in Taoyuan, a two-story house, and the son left the family and went to Taipei for work and live in another different urban environment. Okay, so it is written in the short story. For more than a decade, father had lived in Taoyuan in a two-story house. Because basically in Taoyuan we have this kind of option. We can live in a two-story house. For example, myself, I live in Taoyuan too. I live in a four-story house. But it's very difficult to find a house in Taipei. But I think you can see that. Although it was rather old, it was well maintained, and the neighbors also kept their houses neat and clean. But I think let's not everybody do that because let's not me. My house is very messy. And that was why he and the mother did not want to move. It was nothing like our apartment building. Well, this is a problem of Taipei, apartment building. Because I have said that apartment building has been introduced to Taiwan since the 1960s. So after the development about two decades, there are many urban problems. Our apartment building, where half of the tenants just rented, because if you rent a house in Taipei, you don't have to take care of it so much, because maybe you can rent the house for a year, and another year, next year you will move to another apartment, right? So maintenance standards were low. Motorcycles fill all the available space in the stairwells, and if a light bulb burns out, nobody bothers to change it. So I don't know where you are living right now, but maybe you can find problems in your apartment. And no wonder Hui Mei and I were so eager to move into our own house. And where was the house? James, do you remember? The house, their new house. Where are they going to move into? Yes, and do we know the place named Tianmu?
It's very expensive expat.
Yes, yes. Most of the foreigners in Taipei live there. They like it very much, and it's very expensive. Right? And so we can say that this protagonist, the son and his wife, is a rising middle class Taipei residents. So they have the they can afford to buy the house in Tianmu. So if you have a chance, you can go to Tianmu. If you are in Taipei and you did not go to Tianmu, it's quite a pity because Tianmu is a very great place to visit. Have you ever been to Tianmu? No? So maybe this weekend you can, because it's very easy to find a place, because you know Zhongshan North Road. Zhongshan, you go straight in Zhongshan North Road and to the 7th section, that's Tianmu. Okay. Because in Tianmu we have all kinds of national culture. American, because that's an area resided by foreign ambassadors, so we can see all kinds of culture there. Okay. But this is not related to the short story. Okay. And also, Rwanda also talked about this problem, filial duty. But I think this is another part of American ethics, but this is a very important part of Chinese ethics, especially the ethics of family ethics, because we keep seeing the younger sister of the son is nagging his brother about not living with his family right? This is but I think maybe the fight between the siblings seems to be nonsense, but it reflects social reality and the changing value in Taiwan. This is very important, because the elder son is not necessarily the one who's going to take care of the parents. Because at this stage, in before 1980s, most of the eldest sons, they have the responsibility to take care of their parents. They have to stay in the family, and they cannot go to other places for work or to study. They have to stay with their parents. But after 1980s, after Taiwan became more and more prosperous economically, you have better chances to make a good living outside of your hometown. So you went to, for example, to Taipei or to Taichung or to Kaohsiung, the big cities, and to make a living. So you have to leave your parents. So this is one thing about this short story. So the problem of filial duty. And there's also a very interesting, so the arrangement of the characters is very interesting, because we see a lot of Chinese from different places. So I think this kind of manipulation by the writer is very important, because he just want to Xiao Sa just want you to see the comparisons, the contrast between these characters. For example, in this is from the conversation between Cousin Dao and the sum. The Cousin Dao said that real estate prices were falling like crazy. Then, and I thought, what the hell? I'll cross that bridge when I come to it. This is a very important Chinese idiom, because we say that Chinese are optimistic. We say 船到桥头自然直. This is a kind of optimistic thinking of traditional Chinese, because they thought that because the handover problem is not is although it's very near, because it will happen 11 years later, but he will see what happens then and decide what to do. This is what Cousin Dao decided to do. He did not want to think about the problem so much. And we can't just stop living because of that. Okay? So the psalm says that that's very philosophical. Right? So this is a kind of philosophical of life, of the Chinese way of philosophical of life. And the cousin said that, no, it's not at all. Everybody thinks the same way in Hong Kong. All the rich are ready to pack up and leave for Canada, the United States, or Australia. But it's quite strange, he did not mention the Britain, because many of the rich people in Hong Kong, they will definitely choose Britain. And the poor, they just live one day at a time. Okay, so this is quite a hopeless statement by Cousin Dao. Rachel, do you have relatives in Hong Kong during that time, during the handover?
Yeah.
Do they think the same way?
They were worried, but they decided not to leave.
And they stay in Hong Kong?
Yeah.
Okay. So what about the problem of education? Did they think about sending their children to foreign countries to study? Mm-hmm.
And for college, he's going to go to
America. And do we have any relatives going to Taiwan for study?
No.
No? Okay, so it's pretty much like Jen Jen thought. He doesn't like Taiwan. She doesn't like Taiwan. Okay. Okay. Also, this is the same as Tongqing Lou. In this thing, we see this quotation. Okay. But no matter what the circumstances were 40 years ago, the bonds between husband and wife and father and daughter appear hard to break. From what I could see, it didn't matter whether they had ever been in love with each other. You couldn't just dismiss such bonds on the basis of likes or dislikes. This is the observation made by the son, because in the banquet, he observed the interaction between his father and his grandmother and his elder sister. He saw that there was still something existing between them. This is a traditional way of family relationships. And this is a very important comparison, because in Baijing, the two stories I just mentioned, the two characters, they have very strong devotion to their lovers in the mainland, and to the point that they finally commit suicide or corrupt and die because of that. But in this story, we did not see that kind of relationship. We see two people, the father and the grandmother, they were they get married simply because that they were arranged by their parents and the matchmaker, and they did not have much time to get along with each other, and soon after their marriage, the father went to Taiwan, right? And they did not contact each other for many years, but that kind of bond is still there. Okay, so this is the reason why I want to talk about it, because in the end of this short story, toward the end of the short story, the son made a conclusion that the father thought he hadn't treated the grandmother right, so he had to see her. This is the one reason why the father, who was very he insisted on going to Hong Kong to see the grandmother, because from some perspectives this will be meaningless. So in this quotation, we can think about the traditional way of Chinese marriage and the matchmaking arranged by parents. Couples barely knew each other before getting married, and in this case, this couple they barely know each other after the marriage, because they separated. So they might spend limited time together. So this is the Chinese way of thinking about problem obligation. But when you are married to another person, you have the obligation to that person. And this is what the younger Chinese in Hong Kong thought. Yeah, because Zheng Jie thought Taiwan is a good place, but didn't want to go to Taiwan study. But actually, when I was in my college days, I had some classmates who were from Hong Kong. And maybe you can see in our university, in NTU, there are many students from Hong Kong. And the mindset of the young Hong Kong Chinese, they thought that they were not English. And they didn't want to be communist, and didn't consider Taiwan to be their home. So in a sense, they are very confused. They're very confused about their own identity, because if they chose to stay in Hong Kong, they would become communist. But of course, after all, they did not become communist. As the later development will show us that. So the son's conclusion after his talk with Zhen Zhen, he said that we are all Chinese, but still we were different. This is a problem that you can think about. And the last aspect of this short story is about marriage. I don't think you are married yet, right? Although you are still very young, so you don't have marriage problems, right? Okay, so you can think a little bit about marriage problems through this short story, because we see many comparisons or contrasts in this short story. One of them is the contrast between couples. We see different couples. For example, okay, but this aspect of this short story is autobiographical, because marriage problems once disturbed Xiao Sa greatly during the mid 80s. During the time that this short story was published, Xiao Sa was getting divorced with his husband, and she even published an open letter to her ex-husband. He's a famous film director in Taiwan. Okay. So maybe this is one problem she was thinking about at that time. Of course, many of Xiao Sa's short stories focus on the problem of extramarital affair. Many of the women in the short story, they encounter this kind of problem. They were betrayed by their husbands. Okay. So in this short story, we can see four contrasts. The first set is the mainland father and the Taiwanese mother. I think this In Yolanda's report, she has mentioned that because in this story, we see a very introverted Mandarin father and a very extroverted Taiwanese mother. And one of the great contrasts between these two characters is that maybe you have noticed that because the mainland father barely has any relatives in Taiwan. This is the case with many of the mainlanders in Taiwan. And the Taiwanese mother has many relatives in Taiwan. So once they encounter family problems, the father, the mainland father, he did not have anyone to talk to. He only has a younger sister in Hong Kong, right? And on the contrary, the Taiwanese mother, many of her relatives get together and they talk about the problem, the marriage problem. Right? So this is a very interesting contrast. And the second set is the mainland father and the grandmother. Okay, so we have talked about that. This is also a very interesting contrast. And also the third set is the son and his wife, because in this couple we see the problem, the social problem of Taiwan in the 1980s. What's the problem? Do you remember the problem? Yolanda, do you remember the problem? What's the problem between this? Besides the problem of the $300,000.
The son is working all the time.
Yes.
Time
yes. So basically, this is a problem caused by occupational differences. Because the son is some kind of businessman or worker or office worker for international company, right? And he has all kinds of social engagement. Because his wife questioned that why every time when the Japanese came, you have to drink a lot and stay late at night outside, not coming home or not coming back to home. And on the contrary, his wife has a very regular schedule every day, right? Because he's a home economics teacher in the high school, right? So he's saying before the son went to Hong Kong, the wife asked to move back to her mother's house, right? So this is the problem. And the first problem is the younger sister. Because the younger sister was not married. We see the short story, right? And in traditional society, traditional Chinese society, this is not acceptable, because we in traditional society, a man can be unmarried, but a woman at this age, because we know that the younger sister in this short story is 32, maybe 32 years old. That is the age that you should get married, right? So the problem of his state is a single. This is also a problem. Okay, this is what is about the story. Okay. And now I'm asking you some questions about this short story. So you can use this microphone. Miriam, did you have a chance to read this story? But you can tell us about a little bit about what you read, okay?
Yeah. The first things I noticed was this how the son would react to the couple when they went there, and the mother, his mother was crying because that father would like to go to the Hong Kong. And what I thought about that, the son reacts really calmly, and he doesn't seem to understand the
yes.
mother's side of the
yes.
Argument. And he says that, well, it's okay, he's just going, dad's just going to go there and then he's going to come back.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Yes.
But he doesn't seem to realize how difficult it must be for the mother to suddenly face the fact that she's just a second woman.
Mm-hmm.
And that there's not only another wife but a child as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what strikes me. And
okay, this is also a very important aspect of this short story, because Miriam talked about the son seems to be very calm, right, all the time. Just like I said, this most parts of this short story is presented from the perspective of the son. He's pretty much is an observer of all the events in the short story. So he has to be stay calm in order to observe all the events. And also, this is related to the generation gap. Because problems to the older generation might not be the problems to a younger generation. So I think that's the reason why he stayed calm all the time during the whole incident. Okay.
And they have this same kind of attitude because they lost their homes.
Mm-hmm.
They had nowhere to go to, so they were just slumped in the cities where they didn't necessarily have any relatives or houses, so they were dumped into other people's.
You mean they are refugees? Refugees?
Yeah, they were, because the city's land was really big, and then it included one of the biggest cities in Finland at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And so there were 700,000 people suddenly coming to the other cities, and they didn't have anything because everything was burned in the
mm-hmm.
war.
Right.
So they have, I've heard same kind of attitudes that we have discussed today.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of is interesting to
okay.
for me to write that.
Okay. Okay. And I have to ask one thing to the boys from our class. James, if you were the son, would you go to Hong Kong with the father? And would you understand that you have a great mother?
Yeah, I would. I think it's an obligation,
mm-hmm.
both to my father and to my mother.
Mm-hmm.
When I read the story, I kind of divided it up into two different parts. One part is a part which I think is universal, which everyone can understand, and it's the wife complaining that he's working very hard, he's coming home late, blah blah blah. American women complain about this too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I don't know that before.
And then the second part, so I thought at first that this is somewhat, the story's a bit of a cliche, because I've read these stories and my friends have experienced this firsthand. And then the second part is, this is the part where he has another family on the mainland. And this part also is somewhat of a cliche because so many Taiwanese writers have used the exact same plot.
Yes.
But even though I know what's going to happen, I know the background, it's still moving.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this sort of background, which is very widespread in Taiwan, wife sharing around and coming here, leaving families behind. It's still moving, even though we know about it. So I think the author did a good job of using this type of very widespread background.
Yes, because this is a very common thing among the writings of the Taiwanese authors. But one thing is very special about this short story is that Xiao Sa put this very cliché story into a different context, the context of a handover, the 1997 handover. Because I don't think I have thought I have seen this kind of short story, the same kind of short story before. So this one thing very special about this short story. Okay.
What is the author's personal background? Is she a wife?
Yes, but she, Xiao Sa was adopted. She's an adopted girl, adopted daughter of a mainland family. She was born in a Taiwanese family, and I think maybe in two years old or 3 years old, she was adopted by a mainland family, and. Both of her parents were very old at that time. And later on, maybe before she was 10 years old, she started to know that she was an adopted daughter. Okay, so she maybe she has at the same time the Taiwanese and mainland perspective on his own identity. Yes. And she started to write at a very early age, maybe 15 or 16 years old. And later on, she went into normal college and become a school teacher and write at the same time. And she got married with the film director at a very young age. So she became a very famous screenwriter and author of that. They cooperated on many occasions. Yes.
I think also what's interesting in these stories we've read so far is the main issue seems to be political. You have communists, you have capitalists.
Yes.
And the issue of today's Taiwan, which is ethnic identity, isn't really being touched upon that much in these stories. People are still thinking along political lines. You see, you know, we're all Chinese, we just have different futures. And the futures depend primarily on which political system you're living under. And then later on, now in Taiwan, people don't really discuss political systems. So.
Yes. But I think it's very sad because you know many Hong Kong people are protesting against the mainland invasion recently. Many Hong Kong people they went to the street and make protest to the social problem after the mainlander were allowed to get into Hong Kong. For example, many of the mainland pregnant women they chose to give birth to their children in Hong Kong, and there will be many social problems after this kind of phenomenon. Yeah, so I think maybe of course Taiwan's future is not yet decided. I think. But Hong Kong has a greater problem right now. Okay? Thank you. Let's take a break.
Good. This one. Okay, ma'am.
Maybe a little bit louder, which is good.
Okay.
So I guess I'll just introduce myself really quickly. I'm Dan. I'm from St. Louis, Missouri, which we don't know much about. United States geography is like right smack dab in the center. I go to school in Oklahoma, though. So I migrated further south. I'm not really sure how that happened. This is a picture of the Great Reading Room. It's in the library, and you're not allowed to talk there, which is even, I guess that's how Taiwan's library is too, but it's even more intense than that. You get bad looks if you scoot your chair back. So it's like dead quiet. And we went there on the tour, and I really liked that. And so that and other reasons was why I went to OU, why I chose to go there. But this is what my school is famous for. So, not really exactly why I went there, but well, I'm an economics major.
What's the name of the football team?
Sooners?
Sooners?
Sooners, yeah.
Sooners.
In Oklahoma, when it was a territory becoming a state, they were opening up the land, and it was going to open up on a set date.
Mm-hmm.
But some of the farmers went in before they were officially supposed to get to claim their land first.
Mm-hmm.
So they were called Sooners because they cheated.
Okay. Okay. And are you a cardinal friend? Cardinals.
I should be, but no. I come from one of the biggest baseball towns, and I go to one of the biggest football colleges, and sometimes I miss out on all of that. But I'm an economics major, Chinese minor. I came to Taiwan because I wanted to learn more Chinese. I knew I just wanted to go somewhere. Taiwan worked out really well. It's state funeral. Basically, the story of an old nationalist general's aide reminiscing on his time in the military and going to the funeral of the general that he served for so long. I think my first impression was that since we see that. Encounter a lot of death in the things that we read. Since this story starts with death, I thought it could only go uphill, which is more or less true. But I think that there's two ways to look at this story. One is if you take out the political and cultural context and you just look at the story itself, and it's really just a story of somebody growing old and looking back, and it's a story about growing old. And then the second way that I found to look at it was if you put it back into context, you can learn a lot more about Taiwanese society and politics and culture of that time. So those are the two ways that I learned about looking at it. So first off, it's just a story of aging. And the main character, I believe, Qing Fuguang, or Xin Yifang, depending on which title he's using, is just a guy who got old. And one of the things he feels is very inadequate. Inadequate for a lot of reasons. For one thing, he just got old and he needs to use a cane, yet he relies on a lot of younger people to help him get around now. So that's very, very humiliating, I guess. As well, the cause that he fought for was not successful. China was not unified. The nationalists did not retain their power. So him and, I guess, his generation of nationalists as a whole feel very inadequate in that sense as well. And he was also dismissed by the general he worked so long for because his health was starting to deteriorate. And he was not happy about that decision. So for all of these reasons, the main character feels very inadequate. Like I assume, I don't know, but I assume a lot of old people do. And a lot of other characters in this story feel inadequate as well, that are of the same age. One of the big military leaders who worked under the general that Qin Yifang worked for talked about coming back. I think he was captured by the communists.
Yes.
He talks about coming back and feeling very embarrassed and not being able to go see, go meet his family. I think he got stripped of his rank as well. So really, they're all battling the sense of inadequacy, the generation as a whole. They're also the main character is also very lost in the past. For him, his reality when he looks at China and Taiwan is the great retreat, and he's very focused on that one. And he has difficulty moving forward, which is probably why he continued to serve as his general's aide for as long as he could, despite the fact that they were no longer actively at war. So he's very, very backwards looking. He also has a disdain for the younger generation. He's not very good at relating to them. We know that because he resents the help that he gets from military aides who help him up to the coffin and help him up onto the truck. He's not very appreciative of that. And there's also one point where he goes up to see his old general. And he's told to bow, which apparently he didn't do on his own. So he feels very put out by that, but somebody's telling him to bow, and he's been around for so long and knew the general so well. So he sees himself as apart from the rest of society, apart from this younger generation, that he can't really relate to. And the fact that he has to rely on them for help is even doubly humiliating. He calls them tortoises and sons of tortoises.
Yes.
The fact that a son of a tortoise has to help him get on a truck is very embarrassing. One of the things I forgot to mention before, one thing about me that you may not know is that I have very strong feelings about PowerPoint usage. Namely, one of those things is that I think every PowerPoint should have at least one popular culture reference in it. And so getting to that now, this character, the main character, actually reminds me of another character in a popular movie for the reasons that he was very devoted to someone he loved. And when that person died, he withdrew into himself and away from society. He has a disdain for the younger generation. And it's just old in general, but he reminds me of the old man from a little bit. They have a lot of similarities. Has anybody seen Up?
No.
Okay, it's a great movie. It's really heartwarming. You can't really think of it. Anyway, so the main character in Up has, I guess, the love of his life. He's spent his whole life together since kids and were married. And she dies, and he retreats into himself. Similar to what happened with Qi Fuguang and his general. In this character, he has difficulty relating to younger generations. There's an equivalent of a Cub Scout comes up to him and tries to get him to sign off on one of his badges. The old man here tricks him and sends him away. But they also have one other small similarity. In the book, Qi Yifang uses a cane. And he uses a walker with tennis balls on the bottom of it, and actually at one point beats somebody over the head with it, and gets into trouble that way. But this actually runs deeper than just a random pop culture reference. The old man from Up is able to, overcome his retreat from society and his disengagement with the world through two things. One is getting to know the younger generation. He ends up spending a lot of time, which I have a picture of it, of the kid that comes to see him. And it's from his experiences with the kid that he's able to sort of become interested in the world again. He isn't just focused on the past. And that's how he's able to let go of the fact that he lost the woman that he loved, is because this new generation is here. with its new concerns and problems. He also, yeah, that's the main way he was able to do that. But if you compare it with the main character in this story, he hasn't done that. He has no connection with the new generation. He's probably not going to get a connection with the new generation anytime soon, for what it led to believe. So there's no way out of it for him. The main character here is stuck looking at the past and thinking about the time he spent serving in general, who is now dead. So that's one way to look at it. The second way is putting it back into context, adding historical, social, cultural set. And basically, the context for them is the Chinese Civil War and the Great Retreat. So for them, for Qin Yifan or Fu Guan, people of this generation, they witnessed an event of inevitable significance and have defined their worldview for the rest of their life. Inevitableness means, it's a nice word for saying that it can't be put into words. So Qin Yifan can't really explain to the younger generation what this means. They don't really understand it the way that he does. And he also can't let it go. This is what he thinks of when he thinks of China and his role in the world. This is his defining moment. Some people say that 9/11 is the defining moment of our generation, of Americans. I think that this is true even more so, even more true than that. So it's this idea that they experience something so important that they can't let it go and they can't get away from it. When you think about it that way, it leads to some interesting cultural explanations. If you look at some of the dates, I think this was published in 1971.
Yes.
I'm not totally sure. So this 1971 is when some of the people that fought in the Chinese Civil War would start to die. When some of that generation started to pass away, especially the older members. So the general who was already maybe 40 when the Chinese Civil War was fought, maybe even older, would start to die at this point in time. So this is when it was published. Chiang Kai-shek himself died in 1975, and it seems like for these guys, they saw themselves as nationalists, and their big moment was the Great Divide. So they stayed in that mentality. And one way to see that, it wasn't until after Chiang Kai-shek died that we saw some reforms. The lifting of martial law came in the 1980s, I believe, and allowing other parties came after that. And if you think about Chiang Kai-shek would be older, it was really when the war generation started to die off that you saw these reforms coming. And I think that this was because since they couldn't let it go, they kept seeing the world and imposing their worldview on Taiwan. They say, we're not going to put martial law, we're going to keep things this way. We're going to plan for the reinvasion of China. I learned the other day, Chiang Kai-shek has to be, I don't know if it was, not buried, but just to have his remains put out so he could be buried in China when it was reconquered. And he had that view in 1975, apparently. So that role was stable for a long time. It was only after that died that things started to change. But for the people of that generation, personal inadequacy became political inefficacy. Qin Yifan felt very inadequate, and taken on a larger scale, he wasn't really politically capable either. The reason being is that what he cared about was taking back China from the communists and defeating the communists, which obviously has not happened and probably is not going to happen. Definitely politically frustrated from there. And so in the end, this generation, this character, who's fixed on this one event and can't let it go. But at the same time, it's very futile. They can't do anything to change it. They're stuck with that. And so the only thing that's left for them to do is to salute, is to remember. When you're saluting something, you're just recognizing it. You're not actually doing anything proactive about it. I found that very interesting as well. The only thing for Qin Yifan to do is to salute. And that's the only point in the story, I believe, when he actually stands up straight, when he doesn't need to punch over him in his cane. They can't do anything about the situation. They can't let it go. All that's left to do is salute. This is a picture of Chiang Kai-shek, I believe. At first, I thought he was saluting, but now I think he's just shielding his eyes from the glare. I knew that's the first time. But yeah, that's what I took away from this.
Of course, we know that General Bai Chongxi, the father of Bai Xinyong, died in 1966, almost 10 years earlier than Chiang Kai-shek. Okay? So I think in many ways, this short story is not only about his father, it's also about the generation of his father. Because like Dan said, many of the generals in the same generation as his father started to deteriorate or started to die, pass away, and then became a part of history. So Bai Xiong chose to memorize them in this way, to write stories about them. Let's go through the a little introduction to this general, General Bai Chongxi. He's a deputy chief of staff during the Northern Expedition. And we know that this is a very important thing because this is the military action that brought the KMT to the front of modern Chinese history and made it possible to unite the whole nation of China. Because at that time, we know that there were many warlords all over China. And the KMT, after they set up a military school, we know that it's a Huangpu military school, and they have their own army, and they started to engage in other warlords. And finally, they had a chance to unite China. And also, during the Second Sino-Japanese War, he's also the deputy chief of staff. And he's part in the April 12th incident in Shanghai, because we know that this is, from the communist perspective, this is a massacre of Shanghai, because many of the communists died or were missing in Shanghai. So it's impossible for General Bai Chongxi to defect to the communists, because the communists resent him very much. So he staying in mainland China is not an option for him. And he is also the first Minister of National Defense of ROC from 1946 to 48, after the Second Sino-Japanese War ended. And during the Chinese Civil War, he became the commander of the Nationalist Armies in Central China. I think in this respect, we see the similarities between General Bai Chongxi and General Li Haoran. Because in the last phase of the Civil War, what's left of Bai's army, about 180,000 soldiers, retreated to Hainan Island. Because originally, he has a great army of 600,000 armies of soldiers. And after the continued struggle between KMT and the CDC, General Bai Chongxi lost almost all of his armies, maybe two-thirds of his armies, and only 180,000 left. And he retreated his army to Hainan Island. Just like the General Li Haoran, he waited General Liu Xingqi on the island, right? So this is a detail related to his father. And on December 30, 1949, Bai flew from Hainan to Taiwan. And he lost his political power in Taiwan, dying in 1966. A long list of generals were honored by said heroes, but Bai Chongxi was not on the list because maybe he's a political enemy of President Chiang Kai-shek, and his life is tragic in his last years because there were some rumors about his being poisoned by the KMT government. And this is one thing that we can relate General Bai Chongxi to Li Haoran, because in this quotation we see that General Li Haoran said that if we fall to the death, maybe we could still turn the tide. We never dreamed that the end would be such a debacle. Tens of thousands of Guangdong boys all lost to the enemy just to talk about it. It breaks my heart. This is from Li Haoran. General Li Haoran, and we saw that Bai Chongxi also lost a lot of his soldiers during the war. And from the beginning of this short story, we see Qin Fu Guan, Qin Yi Fang, he entered the ceremony hall, and we see the title, it is listed on the hall, and it's 4-star general Li Haoran. In the military system, only President Chiang Kai-shek was the 5-star general. And if you are a 4-star general, you virtually right at the highest end of your military ranking. So we can know a little bit about this general from this this title. And the general has spent his last years climbing mountains and hunting. This is a pretty Chinese thing, because traditionally, the generals never retire. They, after they retire, they will do something about, they will do something pretty military. They will, they have their own escorts. They have own, their own soldiers. And they went to climb mountains and they hunt. And of course, this is a reference to the famous general of the Han Dynasty, Li Guang, because we know that in history, Li Guang retired, and he's still very active, and he's still very brave, and he went hunting. And in this short story, we see a minor character we know as the young master, because in the ceremony, we know that Qin Yi Fang want to comfort the young master, but the young master did not recognize that old man, right? I think you have known that. And this is quite interesting in all the short stories about generals written by Bai Xianyong. Because in all these short stories, we see young masters, they were all like this one in this short story. For example, the dirge of Liang Fu, this is a story in Taipei people. Dirge is a funeral song, a song playing during the funeral. So dirge of Liang Fu is a traditional Chinese funeral song. And the crystal boys, both of these one short story and one novel are about the death of a general. And the young master, they did not choose military career. And in this short story, we even see the young master pretended to be ill and drop out of the military academy to go off in America. And of course, in this, in the case of the Crystal Boys, the case is not the same, because the general sent his son to America because the son has committed a murder, so he had to send his son to America. And in Chinese, we say that a tigerish father has no doggish sons. 虎父无犬. This is the idiom that we talk about. In China, if you want to be good son, you have to like your father. This is quite simple. And there are, of course, these two memorial scrolls are very important in this show story, because in these two scrolls, the scrolls are they are some kind of decoration hand. In the memorial, in the ceremonial hall during funeral, in these scrolls we see many references to traditional Chinese culture and history. So this is very important. So I have to explain here in a little bit detail. Okay, for example, in this memorial scroll given to General Li Haoran by Zhang Jian. Zhang Jian is one of the his subordinate general of General Li Haoran. Pillar of the state, Eugenius will be remembered a thousand autumns. Of course, these are all understandable. Upon your strategy, victory will follow ever. Your one regret, the yellow turbans were yet to be conquered. So what is the yellow turbans? Yellow turbans is a group of bandits in the Han Dynasty. They their appearance resulted in the destruction of the Han Dynasty. It's in Chinese we call 黄金贼. Okay? So in this sentence, we know that General Zhang Jing was comparing the communist troops or communist armies to these yellow turbans. They thought that they were betrayers. Okay? And of course, he said that General Li is champion for him. Zhuge Liang reborn. Who is Zhuge Liang? You know that. James, do you know Zhuge Liang? And all of you are nodding. And do any of you do not know Zhuge Liang? Rachel, do you know who is Zhuge Liang? No. And Amanda? No. Okay. And Yolanda? Okay. And Smeza? You know who is Zhuge Liang? Okay. Zhuge Liang is one of the most famous general and commander and politician of in the Chinese history. And we know that after Han Dynasty fell apart, there's three kingdoms, right? The dynasty of three kingdoms. One is Han, the other is Wu, and the third is Su, right? The nation we call Su. And the basement of Su is in Sichuan province right now. So Zhuge Liang is the general or the political advisor to the king of the Su, okay? The Su kingdom. So he's very famous and he's loyal to he's famous for being loyal to the Han dynasty and to his king. And he said that Zhuge Liang reborn, so he compared General Li Haoran to Zhuge Liang, a very capable and a very intelligent general. And you swore never to share the same ground with the enemy. This is a traditional political thinking of the Chinese, because like I said, this is a fight to the death struggle between KMT and the CPC. They cannot exist together on the same ground. On the same ground we know as the mainland China. So he said that you swore never to share the same ground with the enemy. Okay? And when 1971 Taiwan retreated from the UN, all the political leaders in Taiwan said that too, because they say that they cannot stand on the same ground with the CPC. Okay. So this is a little bit about the culture or historical allusions in this memorial scroll. And this is another scroll contributed to General Li by Yi Hui, another general, another lieutenant general. He said that in passes and on rivers you fought 100 battles. Forever shall it live immortal. Your honorable name too suddenly arose, and the motto Wu Zhang auto win. Wu Zhang is where Zhuge Liang died. Okay? This is the name of the location where Zhuge Liang died. And the world entire mourns a true hero. Our country, our nation is split in two. Of course, this is about the situation of mainland China and Taiwan. Okay? And how can we bear to see the unending tragedy and woe? When I hear how you went hunting by night, like Li Guang, like I said, he's compared generally as Li Guang at Baling. Baling is a very famous location too, because this is where General Li Guang went for hunting. I asked, was there anyone willing to call back the old general? Was after after Baling, Li Guang was called back by the dynasty to fight against foreign invaders. Okay. And there are three warriors of Li Haoran. Two of them became old and weak, like Dan has reported. Not only the Qin Fu Guan was old, all the generals are old. And the other became a monk, Liu Xingqi. General Liu Xingqi became a monk. And in the general, I mean, General Lee's talk with General Liu Xingqi, there's a sentence that I think is quite important. In the sentence, General Lee said that the whole situation had gotten away from us. It was really no one's fault. Because this is a very common thinking among all the generals at that time. Because first of all, the communists was supported by Soviet Russia, okay, and also the American government chose to implement the hands-off policy on the China problem. What's hands-off problem? Because at first, President Truman, he started to engage in the Civil War problem. And he tried to arrange the negotiations between KMT and CPC. But after all the efforts failed, President Truman chose to implement the policy of hands-off, the hands-off policy. And at one moment, President Chiang Kai-shek's wife, Madame Song Meiling, went to America for help, but Truman rejected it. So this is one reason why they think that maybe ROC was betrayed by American government. Okay, so they don't think that the final outcome of this civil war is everybody's fault, it's nobody's fault. They thought that this is just not something they can control. Okay. And at the last scene of this short story, we see a scene at the Sun Yat-sen Mausoleum on Purple Mountain, because we know that is the most glorious moment of General Lee Hora, because after the second Sino-Japanese War ended, General Lee Hora and Qin Fu Guang went to the place, and they went to. This place that Dr. Sun Yat-sen was buried, and to show their respect to Dr. Sun Yat-sen. This is the mausoleum in Nanking City. So we might ask why the scene was mentioned in this short story. So I think there's two levels of this. Like I said, it was the most glorious moment of General, as well as the aide-de-camp, I mean Qin Yifang, the aide-de-camp of the General, in both of their military careers. Okay. And the second one, it was mentioned to show that General Lee used to be a follower of Dr. Sun Yat-sen. I think this is very important for Chinese, because, of course, the Chinese and the political leaders of the modern Chinese history. For example, Chiang Kai-shek thought himself to be a true follower of Dr. Sun Yat-sen. And at some point, Mao Zedong also thought that he's also a true follower of Dr. Sun Yat-sen, of course, because Dr. Sun Yat-sen's wife was with him, right? He stayed in mainland China after 1949. So he thought that mainland China is the orthodoxical China, not Taiwan. But in Taiwan, the KMT government insists on we are the real Chinese government. Okay, so this is the whole problem. So the whole problem of the political controversies between the two sides of the Taiwan Strait. And I think the symbolic meanings of this story is also very important, because this is not a story of any individual. It's not just a story about the generals or the aide-de-camps. Because besides the contrast between the glory of the past and the decade of the present, there are several aspects to be reflected upon in this. The first one is that the decade of the generals' bodies is not only a physical failure, and its symbolic meaning transcends beyond the individuals to signify the Republic's fall after 1949. So those mainlanders in Taiwan, they are a part of the ROC's history. After they die, maybe their events, the events they went through in mainland China, nobody remember those events. And the second level, on the second level, I think there are generals and really unfilial. Because this is a good, this is a very important question in all Bai Xianyong's show stories. Because maybe Bai Xianyong is very sensitive to this father-son relationship. So in many of his show stories, we can see that. In traditional Chinese ethics, it is unfilial to be unlike one's father. So in a way, 不孝子 equals 不孝子. The first one is an unfilial son. The second one is a dissimilar son. A son who is dissimilar to your father. Okay? All the sons in the three stories are written by Bai Xianyong. I mean the State Funeral and the Dirge of Liang Fu and the Crystal Boys, the three stories, might be judged by some as unfilial, for they are not able to be capable and brave soldiers like their father. And one of them, the protagonist in the Crystal Boys, Wang Kuilong, was even considered as a disgrace to family because his identity as a gay. Okay? And also, in this short story, we also see Bai Xianyong's attempt to write the generals as a part of the history of ROC. Because the generals are all absent from the stories. They all die from the very beginning of the short story. And they are not able to speak for themselves because they are a part of the history. So they have to be reflected upon by their family or their subordinates. Okay, so they are not able to present their own perspectives and ideas because they are historical figures to be commented on and are part of historical events of ROC, such as Revolution of 1911, Xinhai Revolution, or the Northern Expedition, or KMT's military campaign to unite China. The Second Sino-Japanese War and the Chinese Civil War from 1946 to 1949. So if we read this short story this way, we will see that I strongly suggest you should read this book if you want to know a little bit about this the history of modern Chinese. You have to read this short story because I will tell you the reason why. I think this short story is a historical fiction. It's the Bai Xianyong's own version of the Chinese history, modern Chinese history. Because from this short story, we see all these stories, the collection, we see all these stories. For example, New Year's Eve, 岁除, The Last Night of Taibanjin, 金大班最后一夜, and The Dirge of Liang Fu, Winter Night, 冬夜, and the State Funeral, 国葬, all these are related to historical events. For example, from the first one, we know the Dirge of Liang Fu is related to the 1911 Xinhai Revolution. This is the earliest historical event in this collection. And the second one we see, Winter Night, is about the May 4th movement. The May 4th movement is in 1919. Okay. And the third one we see the Shanghai in the 30s. This is about the last night of Taibanjin. Because in that period we know that Shanghai is the Paris of the Orient. Or Shanghai, the Bahi de l'Orient. This is a quite popular slogan during that time. And later on, after the Second Sino-Japanese War broke out, we see in New Year's Eve, there's the 1938 Battle of Taizhuang. This is one of the first victory, Chinese victory over Japanese troops in the war. And in State Funeral, we see the Chinese Civil War. Okay, so this is the way Bai Xianyong chose to represent the history of ROC. I mean, the history of ROC in the first part of 20th century. Okay? So I think if you want to know a little bit about ROC, you have to read this story collection. Okay, that's our report today. And do any of you want to express your idea about this state funeral? Marie, have you read the story? A little bit? Okay, you can give me your impression about this short story. Okay, please tell me, do you like this story, or can you find any similar story in Japanese literature? And what do you Japanese think about the character general? Yeah, general. Because in history, generals are very important figures. We can say that they created histories, right? So maybe there are many literary representations of these generals. So if you can think of something, you can tell me later, okay? Okay. And Smitha, do you have a chance to read this story?
Yeah.
Okay. And are you familiar with all these events in I talk about here? Details, okay. And for example, do you know what is the May 4th movement? Because we are going to read May 4th movement in the coming maybe 2 weeks from now. Are you familiar with how important it is in the history of China? Okay, the May 4th movement, to be very quick, is about, this is a movement to emphasize the importance of science and democracy in China, because in Qing Dynasty, we did not emphasize the system of democracy and the institution of science, because the Qing Dynasty, the government of Qing Dynasty are thought to be anti-scientific and anti-democratic. So after this May 4th movement, people started to come to some kind of enlightenment. They had awareness that we should put emphasis on this democracy and science. So this is the May 4th movement. Maybe we can talk about it later, okay? And Rachel, did you read this story? Yeah, and what do you think of this story?
I thought it was sad and really touching, the devotion that he had to his general, and just the fact that he felt guilty because he almost felt like it was his fault that the general died because he was dead. So it was very...
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you see this from a personal perspective. The general is a person, okay? And do you have any other opinions about this short story? Catherine?
Oh, excellent question about the May 4th movement.
Does that include De Xianzhen? Yeah, De Xianzhen and Cai Xianzhen.
Yeah.
Right, yes.
Barely
Yes, yes. This is, in a sense, this is a, maybe Bai Xianyong feels sorry about this older generation. Yes, because for example, Bai Xianyong himself, he was able to go to America for study, but his father, maybe during his stay in America, his father died. And then after he fought, he was not able to go back to Taiwan before his father died. Okay, so this is very tragic, and written from our Bai Xianyong's own perspective, personal perspective. Okay. Thank you.